Tell me when to go.
Really quick. Yep. Got it.
Jeremy, can you ask them to tell me when to come down?
Sure. I like yours as well. It's amazing. I mean, try to. Set dressing. Fancy meeting you here.
What's up?
A vote for something.
You look amazing.
Should, yeah, so tell. So you need to tell us when.
My arsenal lined up.
Oh man, that's good. You know those were chosen because of the Velvet Underground.
Yes, bananas.
They're banana, like. Are you ready?
Is she ready to come down?
I should come down now, right? Hello and good evening. Welcome to Intelligent People with Their Mouths Full. This is a disputation show in the age of delightenment. My name is Lucy Marble, and I'm your host for this premiere of Intelligent People with Their Mouths Full. It is a Lincoln Douglas style debate show. We sit directly at the intersection of ridicule and reason, each episode focusing on an issue of government policy, current events, popular culture, or nothing at all, as disputed by two thought leaders while being force-fed extreme amounts of food. Now, a little background for you. The Lincoln Douglas style debate, commonly referred to as LD debate or just LD, is a type of a one-on-one debate practiced mainly in the United States at the high school level. It is sometimes also called values debate because the format traditionally places a heavy emphasis on logic, ethical values, and philosophy. This format is named for the 1858 Lincoln-Douglas debates between Abraham Lincoln and Stephen A. Douglas because their debates focused on slavery, morals, values, and the logic behind it. So tonight, in their footsteps, we will be debating nothing less than the hot topic of the Velvet Underground, a band originally active between 1964 and 1973, formed by Lou Reed and John Cale, and later managed by the famed Andy Warhol, who added female singer Nico to the band because they needed a femme fatale. Though initially commercially unsuccessful, they are often cited as one of the most influential rock groups of all times, which leads us to our debate topic this evening. Is it true that everything that happened in rock music following the Velvet Underground did first? Now, to argue both sides of this topic, joining us this evening is Jeremy Lindsay, and musician formerly of the design studio Diller, Scofidio, and Renfro Architects. Lindsay has collaborated with cultural theorist Paul Virilio on an extensive installation at the Fondation Cartier in Paris, worked on the Highline Park in downtown Manhattan, and the recent renovation of the Cooper Hewitt Design Museum. Lindsay has also worked with artist-designer Vito Acconci, as well as Cohn Peterson Fox & Associates, on a number of conceptual and built projects. Lindsay has also been a guest critic at Columbia University, Dartmouth University, the Cooper Union, and a teaching assistant at Princeton University, where he received his master's degree. When he's not practicing architecture, Lindsay fronted the band Summer Lawns and is presently developing a solo music project still to be named. Opposite Jeremy is Gates Bradley, a closet savant, an editor, motion graphics animator, producer, and native Alabamian. He co-founded the creative boutique and post-production studio Super, All Right, in Austin, Texas, with clients including Viacom, TV Land, Nickelodeon, Dell, and South by Southwest. He left in 2009 to explore South America, where he kept busy filming, editing, and creating motion graphics with such groups as La Blogothèque, Zizek Records, Transmission Entertainment, and IFC. While in South America, he became enamored with the unique street art scene and is currently developing a documentary about it with Graffiti Mundo. A New Yorker since 2010, Gates is a specialist in jaywalking, the author of a video series about jaywalking, whose name escapes me, and an avid collector of vinyl records. Visit him on Vimeo, Gates Bradley. Now, each guest this evening has prepared an argument on the topic of the influence of the Velvet Underground. So, gentlemen, coming up next, we'll introduce the format and get you ready for talking with your mouths full. But first, a note from our sponsors.
Okay, so here we are back with Modern Intermezzo.
Yes. I'm looking at this.
Right, that's the sound volume. With Dr. Weiss, which is me, with Julian Jovanovic, and with Peter Gutkovic. Two experts, child experts.
Child experts about science?
No, about the museum. What do you think the museum is? What do you think this is?
It's about like a big box of like stuff. Inside, like pictures,
right?
And like we have like a little table, and this is like
what is that?
And like inside, there's like a little thing.
What do you think? Peter?
And like it's like a little house mm-hmm. that has pictures. Mm-hmm. And this is like a book of like
a book,
a kind or so.
Okay, all right.
Or it could be a picture.
What do you think about white walls? Oh, where is this?
This is a little like over here. I don't know what language that is.
Well, it's
Chinese, I guess. Yeah. And over here he
like, will this take a long time?
I don't know.
Peter, what do you think the museum is?
What do you think the museum is, Peter?
The museum is like a place. It's like a place that has lots of interesting stuff, and it like reminds you about stuff that you have saw,
and like. It's about science
stuff that changes you.
And welcome back to Intelligent People with Their Mouths Full. We're about to enter our initial round of debate. Now, here are the rules. Number one. No empty mouths. You must have a full overstuffed mouth at all times. No half full, no hamster cheeking. Only full, open, wide, overflowing mouths allowed. 2, be articulate. 3, food goes in your mouth and only your mouth. No spitting, no throwing, no puking, no projectile vomiting on your opponent, your audience, or your host. 4, safety is our 1 priority. No choking. If you think you're choking, don't. Now, we are ready to get started. So we will proceed in the following format. Guest A will present an affirmative argument in 4 minutes, no more or no less. Guest B then will form a rebuttal question in 1 minute, and guest A will have 2 minutes to refute. Then we will switch and do this over again. The audience will vote via marshmallow at the end, and only at the end. The winner will be declared by the quantity of marshmallows thrown at your head. We ask the audience in the meantime to keep their marshmallows intact, unsticky, and to themselves for the duration of the debate. Now, we'll take another short commercial break, do some stretching in the meantime, and come back to start round 1 of Intelligent People with Their Mouths Full. And we are back and about to begin the first round of Intelligent People with Their Mouths Full, debating the influence of the Velvet Underground on generations of musicians to follow. Jeremy and Gates, are you ready?
We are ready.
Great. Now, we have 2 genres of ingredients in front of you. 1. Jeremy, you have the cooked. Thank you, Claude Levi-Strauss. We have an amazing Entenmann selection here. Plain donuts, glazed donuts, powdered donuts, chocolate donuts,
I'm like a
yellow
candy
cake.
Candy store. That's amazing.
Yep, pink cake. Okay. Now, our rules are that you must continually feed yourself while talking. If you slow down, I will whack you with a spoon or...
Wait.
Slightly for, yeah. Or.
I just don't want my opponent to not know what
you're doing. Yeah. Balance. or I force feed you, which you don't want.
Yes.
Now, you will be timed. You will be timed in your 4-minute affirmative arguments. When your time is up, should you go over time, you will hear a burp.
Excellent.
A burp.
Perfect.
That is a burp. All right, so let's Rochambeau to kick this off.
Okay.
Please stand.
Oh, stand, yeah. Should we go in the middle?
Yeah.
All right. Once, twice, three, shoot.
Ah. Paper wins over rock. Ah. Gates, Bradley, you will begin. Your argument, please. Now remember, an audience, please take this into note. You will be judging on quantity of mouth full, ability to articulate, lack of spitting on opponent, host, or audience, and no choking. Gates.
Okay, so, this is where the rubber on the ground, I'm showing everything that has been done in rock music to look around. Well, nothing has been done. The underground has not gone through. I don't know what way you look at the spectrum, the music, American Indie, Grunge, Fidel Music, down in some form or fashion, later or directly just did all this stuff. I need to refer to my notes. Well, I have a few examples. Took the day, for example. Free joy, free gas, North, local content. I mean, directly saying, like, I can't do this or that because this guy's sucking on my ding dong. That's some explicit shit. A tip of gore. Nowhere to be seen at this time. If you want to take today's dark confessional.
And that's time. Thank you. So we will take a short commercial break through which opponent Jeremy Lindsay will formulate a rebuttal question. See you soon.
Okay, welcome back to Modern Intermezzo. This time with Dr. Weiss. And our technical assistant is unfortunately has a deadline, writing deadline, so he cannot join us. But here with us is Julian Jovanovic and Peter Gutkovic. We're talking about architecture.
For kids.
What is architecture?
I have no idea.
So this is an American National Exhibition in Moscow.
Wait, no, no, it's like...
You know.
It's like building stuff.
Okay.
It's like making like models.
Like that one?
Like big like dome things.
Dome,
or stuff.
Yeah.
And like buildings. Like really tall buildings, skyscrapers. Peter, what do you think?
I think they design stuff like in your lab, like they make like a humongous building out of curves and stuff. Well, not too big.
Do you see those highways over there?
Yeah.
Wow. That's LA.
And what the and like stuff. And we'll see you in the next episode of this. Bye. Say bye, Peter.
Bye-bye!
Okay. Welcome back.
Welcome! We are now back to intelligent people with their mouths full. We've just heard an affirmative argument for the Velvet Underground's influence on generations of music, as per Gates Bradley. We will now hear a question from Jeremy Lindsay refuting the argument. Jeremy.
Gates, I think what you're saying is fascinating and also one of rock's biggest cliches. My question for you is, as Lester Bangs once said, many, many critics bought those Velvet Underground, but those records were in pristine condition. They were never scratched. Don't you think that the Velvet Underground inspired bands, but most of them were obscure, and in the end of the day, at a very small movement in rock history?
Oh, not at all, Jeremy. Not at all. That's ridiculous. You know, the first thing the Velvet Underground ever did, before they had any rock and roll, you had the Beatles and the Rolling Stones and Elvis. The Velvet Underground was the first band that made being a loser, a weirdo, an outcast, made it cool. All the bands that come afterwards, that's what it was. Where did music go after the Velvet Underground? What's the punk rock? Punk rock was a judicial tactic. And a different franchise making music that I love. After that, I'll play the music. And the music is Nirvana. Would Nirvana be allowed for the Velvet Underground? Is Nirvana a small band with just a small audience? I think so. I think this is the popular music as we know it. And you can say the same thing about everything. So, see that I built a hangar again. This is a small built like this. What? This is a small built like this. That has no phone. I put it left the dance himself. Said that Liberti's band machine music was the penultimate album of all time. Rose for Banks was the biggest level underground fan that ever lived. He went to Louis as an idol. So the idea that Better Underground is just some weird thing that happened without any like repercussions on the larger course of popular music is absurd. No, I mean, anyway, Dave Boy, Grandma, I mean, Better Underground was the first band to like use gay imagery and speak openly about being gay or being a transvestite.
Thank you, Gates. Thank you, Jeremy. Now we will return after this short commercial break to hear the other side of the argument from Jeremy Lindsay. Audience, please take note, assess once again to review. Quantity of mouth full, articulation of argument, lack of spitting, throwing, projectile, vomiting, and no choking. We'll see you just after this commercial break.
Thank you.
Welcome back. There's some excitement in the crowd. We've seen Gates with a true feat of celery eating. Never have we seen such green froth at the mouth of such a human. We will now be entering round two of Intelligent People with Their Mouths Full, featuring Jeremy Lindsay on the other side of the argument. Has the Velvet Underground really changed generations of music to come? Now, Jeremy, you will have 4 minutes to present your affirmative argument while eating donuts, 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 black and white cookies, and yellow pink cake. You may choose any style of eating that you like. Once again, to remind you, the burp will signal your time. You may now begin.
And the question is, did the Velvet Underground do everything that had been done? And my answer very simply is no. Well, first of all, the donuts are very dry. First of all, there's like a sound barrier. So, you take a band like Led Zeppelin. Now, Led Zeppelin could care less about the Velvet Underground. Because, really, they listen to the blues. And the blues is all you needed when you wanted to make rock and roll. So, Led Zeppelin turned into rock and roll, and it is very deep. And it's the rock and roll so big that everybody came to see the rock and roll. And the rock and roll is really sexy. Yeah, that's all right. So. So then, secondly, the Velvet Underground were very cool. Everybody liked how cool they were. However, it took someone like David Bowie, can you hear me, guys? David Bowie, who was like the Velvet Underground, but was actually influenced that. So he was doing very original things that had nothing to do with these donuts. Really don't really see this, like, cement. The third point is that the Velvet Underground had a very limited palate. They didn't have lots of donuts either. So, the Velvet Underground had the bass and dungeon guitars. Well, someone like Brian Eno had African rhythm, had synthesizers, had all kinds of things. So he really loves the but so were many other people.
There were many other people. But a few other things that were as interesting.
And took what the Velvet Underground did, but moved it a little forward. Because I think it's important for rock music and for life in general. We have to keep moving things forward. We can't live in the past. We can't feel like everything has been done. If it had, why would I get out of bed in the morning? Why would I eat donuts? I wouldn't. It has been fun. I don't know if anybody's eaten donuts and talked this long about the Velvet Underground. Maybe. But I do think, yeah, some of the most amazing things really happen because the Velvet Underground were able to back. That people could then respond to.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Yes. Now we've just witnessed approximately 8 donuts being eaten for the Velvet Underground. With this in mind, we will break for a short commercial while Gates formulates a rebuttal argument. Stay tuned.
Okay, welcome back to Modern Intermezzo with Peter Gutkovich and Julian Jovanovich.
Yeah.
We will be talking about the same exhibition, American exhibition in Moscow from 1959, and about the revolutionary haircuts.
Yeah.
For kids. So tell me what you see.
There's a girl and she's like crouched and there's like loads of people in the background.
Yeah, this was
And there's people who are like have like haircuts, but they aren't like normal haircuts. Like they're like more hair on like one side than the other side.
Yeah, and all of the haircuts are pretty different, and there's pictures and
Yeah, it's a Soviet youth.
Yeah, it doesn't really look
and like. Some people got their hair cut so they could be bald. Some people got it so their hair is very short. Some people got it so their hair is very like
gone,
like mixed, and like.
So Peter, you're Russian. Is this a normal haircut today?
What?
Is this a haircut that happens today as well?
I think.
So what do we what do we conclude?
Okay.
Good haircuts or okay haircuts?
Okay.
I'd say like okay, and like we have almost just like run out of time in this episode. We shall see you in the next episode. Bye.
Okay.
And welcome back to Intelligent People with Their Mouths Full. We've just heard a statement on the Velvet Underground spoken full of chocolate donuts. Now, as a counter question, Gates Bradley, what do you think of Jeremy's argument?
Well, first I would posit that David Bowie and Brian Eno were contemporaries of the Velvet Underground, not so much after, which... But, so then, like, things happen concurrently. That's different than things that will be influenced later. But I will say this. Do you think that, what did Brian Eno and David Bowie do exactly that the Velvet Underground didn't do vis-a-vis the genre of rock music specifically?
Ready? Jeremy.
Well, first of all, rock music had a couple things. It was sexy, it was free, and it looked good. It looked really good. Now, the Velvets looked good. Now, they had rock and roll.
It was sexy, and it was
really free. And they had all those things. But what David Bowie did, to answer your question, was he took the idea of fashion and created rock and roll around this idea of fashion. That was very different from what the Velvets were doing, and very unique. No, the Velvets really only wore black leather all the time. David Bowie had like 15 different outfits. I think he liked a lot of things. And then he was a play different one. And then he was like the thin white Duke. Oh. That's a lot. Secondly, Brian Eno, a rock music, he introduced African polyrhythm back into music with a talking head in Remaining Light, Born in a Lifetime. It was amazing. And what happened was, with that introduction, music reclaimed the African roots that rock in our country had. And it was beautiful. Very nice. Oh, I love them. So that's two examples. The Velvets were great. But I hope.
Yeah.
You got my point.
Are you laughing because you know you're
arguing? That's time. What a rebuttal argument. Jeremy and Gates, thank you for this vivacious and full debate. Now, we will shortly be taking yet another commercial break. Audience, during this time, you will be charged with deciding the winner of Intelligent People with Their Mouths Full. Now, let me remind you, what we are judging on is, number one, fullness of mouth. Number two, articulation. Number three, lack of spitting. Number four, didn't choke. It also would help if you liked their argument and didn't like their argument. We will then be back from a note from our sponsors. Intelligent people with their mouths full. This is the final moment of deciding who wins the Lincoln-Douglas style debate. Lincoln and Douglas would be proud. They debated issues of slavery, values, ethics, and philosophy. And tonight, we have heard resounding arguments from Gates Bradley and Jeremy Lindsay on the impact of the Velvet Underground on the future of generations of music. So, audience, we will now ask you to take the fate of these two individuals into your own hands. And when I announce each name, please show your support of each by throwing marshmallows in the direction of the winner. We will start with Gates Bradley. Now, Gates chewed the raw, not the cooked. Celery, bananas, romaine hearts, and even a little bit of apple.
Young, That was a nice Fine Young Cannibals reference.
I know nothing about music. Yeah. So, for those of us who have chosen gates, please throw marshmallows in this direction. Wow, that was a resounding burp. Thank you. Thank you. There, we also have some shrapnel on the floor. Now, on the flip side, Jeremy Lindsay uttered moments such as Bowie and other things.
It was impenetrable.
Yes. For those of us who choose Jeremy Lindsay, please throw marshmallows now. Oh! Oh! Ah! Excellent. Excellent. ladies and gentlemen, I say that we have a winner, Jeremy Lindsay. Oh, congratulations on being the first winner of Intelligent People with Their Mouths Full, proving once again that you are intelligent, full in mouth, and able to articulate eating crap. Now, if this amused you, please remember, please come back, that in life, we must be full, articulate, don't spit, and please never choke. Until next time, this is Intelligent People with Their Mouths Full. Do it again. Oh, you all look so good. Bye, Carlos. Oh, that's amazing, a cornucopia of beauty. Okay, the end. Thank you so much. You did an amazing job. Okay. Thank you very much for attending our premiere.
Johnson,
if you would like romaine, hard celery, apples, carrots.
Fresh sangria and a few bonbons of some very righteous boo. I brought out a box of live Sonic Youth tapes. We were arguing about Ronaldo's
tongue. Could you play some music?
In the third quadrant of society.
Done. Do you want a pie?
When one of Timur's downstrokes caught our attention. We ran the tape back and listened to the passage a few times. The subtle yells to us.
It's so good. Can you play some? That was amazing.
Made it our way.
Can we play music? Yeah. Let's play some music. They play two commercials now?
I'm going to play one. Like, two of the commercials didn't have audio, apparently.
It meant that he was capable
of actually amazing.
In his brain, loosing demons of soul.
That went really well.
Because we hate to see him.
Amazing.
To jive in his prostration. I'm going to go to the next one.
Here we are back with modern information.
Yes. I'm looking at this.
Right. That's the sound volume. With Dr. Weiss, which is me, with Julian Ivanovich and Peter Woodkovich. Two experts, child experts.
Child experts about science?
No, about the museum. What do you think the museum is? What do you think this is?
It's about... it's a big mall. And inside there's like a little thing. Or it could be a picture.
What do you think about white walls? Oh, where is this? White walls. Oh, where is this?
Yeah. It's like a place that has lots of interesting stuff, and it like reminds you about stuff that you have saw,
and like that, it's about science
stuff that changes you.
Okay, so here we are back with modern intermezzo.